Now, see, this is a video I've been meaning to put together for a hot minute. Now, before I get into the rant, I want to make something perfectly clear. None of what's about to be said or shown in any way, shape, or form is an attempt to diss LaShawn Thomas or encourage anyone to send any kind of disrespect or hatred his way. I kind of got to say that for, you know, legal reasons, because I don't want nobody blaming me for how other people may feel about old boy for their own personal reasons. Now that that's out of the way, let's get to it. LaShawn Thomas is a Bronx-born animator. He's worked in various projects within the animation industry, ranging from both Western animations to anime. According to his IMDb page, projects he's worked on as a storyboard artist or an animator consist of works such as Avengers Assemble, Ultimate Spider-Man, Batman the Brave and the Bold, Justice League Action, The Batman, Avatar Legend of Korra, and most notably, The Boondocks and Black Dynamite. At some point in time, LaShawn wanted to get more into the know of how things are put together and what makes an animation what it is, but he found out that a large portion of animation, mainly when it comes to stuff like in-betweens, which is how an animation plays out from point A to point B based off the keyframes, are actually outsourced and done overseas, you know, like factory jobs. Now, he decided that the best move would be to move overseas, specifically to South Korea, because it turns out that South Korea does a hell of a lot of work for the Western animation side. Think of any really popular American cartoon, 9 times out of 10 South Korean animators have worked on it. Now, after some time in South Korea, he began to gain a stronger grasp of what makes an animation, to the point that he became the overseas guy, basically the link between Western animation studios and Eastern animation studios. Eventually, he go on to create his own original anime shows, and that's what I'm about to talk about in this video. Those anime shows being Children of Aether, Cannon Busters, and Yasuke. Recently, I sat down and rewatched all three of these shows just to make sure I remember them the way that I remember them, and also to be sure on where I stood on these shows. Now, just for a heads up, there will be spoilers for all three of these shows, so if you haven't seen any of them and you don't want to be spoiled, then you can go ahead and check them out on YouTube and Netflix. Alright, so boom. First up is Children of Aether. Children of Aether came out back in 2017. It's about this woman named Rhonda. She's in this post-apocalyptic, dystopian future type of world dealing with assassins, gangs, raiders, and supernatural type stuff, while she looks for answers about this strange, weird power that she's got inside of her called the Aether. The animation is actually pretty good. The voice acting is also decent. The story...
What's "and" supposed to mean?
Just means "eh."
Now, see, it starts out with Rhonda being chased by this masked woman who seems to want revenge because apparently Rhonda killed her own father, or something like that. Now, during the fight, her powers activate and she causes the train to derail inside the tunnel. She wakes up, some story of the plot is explained through these underground kids that she meets. She then finds an underground society of people, and we find out Rhonda's father was like a leader amongst these people because, you know, he kept the gangs from basically tearing each other apart. So we know that Rhonda's father was an important societal figure, but what we still don't know is what this Aether power is that she has. Now, after a fight scene she has with one of the gang leaders, she goes to look for someone who could give her answers that she needs. Turns out that the woman she's looking for isn't around right now and she's somewhere else, so that prompts her to go look elsewhere for her answers. Then the short film ends at about a 15-minute mark or so. To be honest, it shows promise for a pretty interesting anime, but 15 minutes just ain't enough time to properly create an interest in an IP, at least not for me personally. Now, if this was more like the usual anime OVA, which is usually like about an hour and some change, maybe even 2 hours, either that or it would be split up into about 3 or 4 30-minute episodes, then it would give a lot more time for some world-building groundwork to be properly laid out. I don't know, like maybe 15 minutes was all they wanted to show for this story, or I don't know, maybe that was all that they was given for the budget, because, you know, animation is hella expensive after all. But all in all, there's not much else I can say about Children of Aether other than it is what it is. I give it a 7 out of 10 for its potential. If you want to check it out, it's on YouTube on the Crunchyroll channel. Next up, is Cannon Busters. Cannon Busters was released in the summer of 2019. The story is about a kingdom under siege and its missing prince. So, a fugitive, a friendship android, and a maintenance robot walk into a bar. It's like I'm getting ready to tell a corny ass joke, don't it? So these two robots, Sam and Casey, are trying to get back to the kingdom of Bartica, I think it's called, and they need the help of the fugitive named Philly the Kid. Now, the setting of the world of Cannon Busters comes off as a combination of various animes, such as Cowboy Bebop, Samurai Champloo, Gundam, Trigun, Outlaw Star, and Record of Lotus War, with like a pinch of Ghost in the Shell in there. So basically a Western, steampunk, cyberpunk, mecha, sci-fi, action fantasy. Now I'm not saying that blending different genres within the same narrative is a bad thing, nor am I saying that it's impossible. I do believe that these different genres can actually work within the same setting if it's written well enough. But in all honesty, I don't feel like Cannon Busters blends them all together that well. First off, there's parts of the world that look like there's something out of Blade Runner. Then other parts look like they're out of The Quick and the Dead, and then other parts look like they're from the setting of Lord of the Rings. It's like various points in time exist within different parts of the map all at once. One minute you're in the Old West, the next minute you're in the distant future, then the next minute you're in medieval times. Now like I said, blending these different genres could actually work if they're written well. But in this case, it comes off as a bunch of shows that have just been thrown together and they're calling it one show. The tone just feels inconsistent after a while. Then there's the characters. Now when I first saw the Kickstarter for Cannon Busters, I had this feeling that Philly was gonna be my favorite character. I mean, his design and all that stuff just looked fire. But then the show comes out and I personally found Philly the Kid more annoying than anything. Now first off, there's his whole immortal thing and his healing factor. This could have made him a more interesting character if he didn't get killed damn near every single episode. I mean, come on son, after a while this shit starts getting old. He just gradually becomes more difficult to take seriously as a character as the show goes on. Dude literally just has one badass moment in the entire show, and then that's about it.
Get off your fat ass and come get me.
Now this son of a bitch, light him up.
Walking into the sunset song. Because that's what the hell I'm about to do.
Now the rest of the show, Philly just gets killed, gets trapped, gets killed, gets tricked, gets killed again. It gets pretty old pretty fast to the point it's just a running gag. It's not even like it's a funny running gag. I mean, except for that one part like on the last episode when he falls and Casey tries to catch him, but then Philly just ends up getting splattered because he just got caught by a giant metal hand. Which, if you think about it, that's exactly what should have happened to the characters in the Transformer movies. But when I saw that part of the show, I was like, alright, that's actually pretty funny. But for the most part, it's like, you ever watch someone play a walkthrough of a video game on YouTube and the person just keeps getting murked over and over and over, and it just gets to the point where you're like, yo, this nigga sucks, bro. It would have added more to his character if it turns out that Philly was really that nigga and everybody who managed to kill Philly in the past was just actually built different. Then it would make more sense as to why so many people were after him and his bounty was just so high, because now you're thinking like, damn, this dude is really nothing to play with. I'm talking about some Himura Kenshin, Vash the Stampede type status. But nah, all we got was this incompetent dumbass whose only interesting aspect is that he can resurrect after getting murked, and he also has a car that can turn into a mech when you put some quarters in it. Now Sam is a character I can tell they wanted to be the quirky cute type, you know, which she does give off that kind of vibe, especially when she starts learning how to talk some shit. It's pretty cute. But what annoyed me about her character is her abilities. The fact that her powers aren't used under her control is what irritated me the most. Like, she's basically this OP ass android cyborg partially human thing that can easily obliterate the enemies that the squad has to deal with throughout the show, but her powers only activate basically when the plot needs her to be that strong. Like, she's a literal deus ex machina for when the Cannon Buster squad is in a tight spot. Now Casey is fine. She's just adorable. The Red Samurai dude was cool, but he was barely in the damn story. All we know is that he has a dark past, and his dark past is the reason for why he's such an alcoholic. But despite being inebriated most of the time, he's still a force to be reckoned with. But he's barely in the damn story, bruh. Now, the story overall, the writing feels all over the place and inconsistent to the point that you start losing track of what the story's even about, let alone what's even happening or where this thing is even going. It's like there was an idea for what was supposed to happen, but then a completely different writer took over and just started throwing in a bunch of what the fuck. It doesn't give off that episodic feeling that you get from a show like Cowboy Bebop or Samurai Champloo. With those shows, despite the fact that the Bebop crew are still doing all kinds of tasks and going on their own solo adventures before they return back to the Bebop and tell each other all about it, or not, we as an audience are still aware that there's an ultimate ending point for the story and that the story is building up to this final clash with the overall antagonist of the show. We all know that Spike is going to have his clash with Vicious at some point. We all know that Mugen and Jin are going to have to fight with the Sunflower Samurai at some point. But with Cannon Busters, we have a feeling that the show is going somewhere, but we're not exactly sure where the where is. You know, it's like things are just being made up as the show goes along, which is why I think the story doesn't feel very cohesive. Things just happen. Just don't think about it too much. There's the beginning, there's pointless filler, and then there's the ending. Philly is practically a wandering archetype with no real motivation or purpose. Or at least we don't find out what his motivation even is until we're like halfway through season one. Turns out he wants to kill the prince because Philly's parents were killed by his people or something like that. But here's the thing though, the whole motivation could have and should have been revealed in episode one, or at least earlier than episode six. Throughout the entire show, we get little bits and pieces of explanation as to why Philly wants to kill the prince so badly. It would have made the tension that they tried to create between Philly and Sam hit a lot harder than it did. It just didn't feel real, let alone earned. The villain of the story hardly felt relevant, mostly because he doesn't even feel like a character that's really a part of the show. Like, his henchmen had more of a presence than he did. Even when the villain kills the prince's father, it doesn't really feel all that impactful. I mean, we don't even really get any scenes with the prince and his father sharing dialogue. Hell, even in flashbacks, we don't really get any of that. All we do get is to hear the prince act like a spoiled little biatch and rant to Sam and Odin about how he doesn't want to be like his pops. That's it. There's hardly a connection that feels broken at that point. So the audience can't exactly feel what's supposed to be felt by those characters in that scene. If anything, I'm sure people felt worse when Odin was in tough spots because, you know, he seemed more like a father figure to the prince than his own pops did. Don't even get me started on the Red Samurai, this old useless strong motherfucker. You would think he'd be like a new addition to the team, but then he just vanishes into thin air like an episode later. We get a flashback of his dark past, and then he just pieces the hell out for literally the rest of the show, but then got the nerve to show up after Hilda gets hollowed. Now, I know this scene was supposed to be like a hype moment, like, oh shit, the samurai dude is back, yo, it's curtains for the villains now. But hell no, I ain't happy to see you, nigga. You let the big woman get murked.
Fuck you, bruh.
And then Philly keeps on just aiming his gun at the prince, and I'm like, dog, either take the shot or don't. Then it turns out, this dumbass forgot to bring extra bullets.
Nigga!
Again, I swear, I don't know how this guy even got his reputation, bro. You wanna know what would've been cool? Is that even if they were gonna have Philly be like a more goofy type of character, he could've still been a legit badass though. Take Dante from Devil May Cry for example. Every game he's doing some cool looking shit, but then sometimes something goofy will happen and throw off the whole badass vibe and it just becomes comedic. However, it doesn't make Dante come off as any less of a badass, let alone a formidable character. And when Dante has serious moments, you know from the jump, all right, joke time is over, shit just got real. But when Philly and Cannon Busters, he's just a goofball. And like I said, he only has one badass moment in the entire show. Even when things are supposed to be serious moments, it doesn't really feel all that serious. Forced is the more appropriate term, because again, these moments don't feel real or earned. They just feel like an attempt. Even when Philly decides to squash the beef with the prince, it still feels fake. It ain't like old boy came into some info that just made him doubt his grudge against the prince in the kingdom. You know, like, there's nothing that happens that makes him question whether or not killing the prince is the right thing to do. Like, he just has the prince at knife point and then he just stops and he's like, nah, killing you ain't right. Turns out we're not so different from each other after all. Bro, what the fuck is even happening right now, bro? Like, now, I ain't the best writer in the world. I'm still reading up on stuff like create story conflict, creating character arcs, manga in theory and practice, and other things of the sort to learn how to write a proper narrative for my own comic books. But even I can tell that this shit was just sloppy writing.
That was real sloppy, nigga.
What?
Yeah.
Now, Sam turns into her final form and beats the henchmen villains, but then has an internal conflict when she's about to off Philly because he's threatening the prince, who is her main priority. So then she ends up powering down and she passes out. The henchmen re-kidnap the prince and skedaddle the hell off back to the main villain's lair. The squad then plan to rescue the prince yet again, which serves as a way to set up a second season. I'm honestly hoping there is a season two. I mean, I heard rumors that it's in the works, but hopefully the writing and everything else is structured a lot better this time. I don't know what the hell happened behind the scenes. Maybe there was some turmoil in the writer's room or something. I don't know. But this whole thing came off as like a first draft that got greenlit. At times, it also felt like it was trying too hard to be anime, if you catch my drift. Like, it felt like a Western animation trying to convince you that it's actually an anime. All I can say is that the voice actors tried their best with what they were given to work with. But the animation itself is fine for the most part. For a lot of the animation I would say is very standard, meaning that it meets today's standards of a quality animation. You know, it didn't feel like the old early 2000s anime. If you've ever seen any of those, then you know what I'm saying. Now, one thing I really did like about this anime was the character designs, especially when it comes to the female characters, because I mean, damn. Oh, so that's why Bridge wore that big trench coat, trying to conceal all that metal yamage. Damn, even the giant robot is thick. Let me chill. But see, fan service ain't enough to get me interested in an anime. Cause see, when I say that I watch anime for the plot, I actually mean I'm looking for like a legitimate story and narrative. I don't mean like how all the motherfuckers on the internet be like,
when I say I watch anime for the plot, I mean the plot being titties.
Nah, there's websites I can go to if I want to look at some tig old bitties all day. Anyway, then for the action scenes, it'll get pretty damn crazy with the Sakuga. However, there are some parts of the animation that look a bit weird or looks like the frame rate dropped by about 30%, like how the character's mouths would just look like chomps instead of actual speech patterns, or like right here with the chick that's walking on the treadmill, or like Philly right here who didn't unlock the rest of the level just yet. Like, bro, did y'all start running low on budget or something around these parts? I'll also say that the soundtrack also slaps. Overall, I give the show about a 6.5 out of 10. Hopefully season 2 is better if season 2 is actually in the works. Lastly, we have
Verith Prophecy. Black warrior one day come to save the people. I found
Yasuke. Now, Yasuke is based off the real-life figure who was known as the first black samurai. But this dude was an African who was brought to Japan by these Italian merchants and slave traders. And he ended up catching the interest of Nobunaga Oda and ended up being trained in the way of the samurai. Now, that's about where the anime and the real-life story end their similarities. Going into the anime, I wasn't expecting like a one-for-one adaptation of the real Yasuke's life story, especially since no one knows how his actual story ended in real life after Nobunaga's death. So, you know, it's one of those, it's left to interpretation type scenarios. But see, I was hyped to hear about it because the news that there'd be a Yasuke anime didn't come out too much later after the news came out that Chadwick Boseman was actually supposed to play a live action version of Yasuke. Something else I was definitely hyped for. But then of course, you know, the unfortunate news about Chadwick's passing happened and you know, it was a change of plan. Now, I heard the actor who plays Asane Diop from the show Lupin is supposed to be the new actor who's gonna take on the role of Yasuke in the live action movie. And since I've seen Lupin, which is a dope ass show by the way, I think this guy could actually pull it off, so it should be interesting to see. But anyway, on to the anime. So Yasuke shows up in Japan. He fights some dude who's bullying on the little kid and is about to like beat his ass. So he defends the little kid, beats the shit out the dude who's about to beat up the kid, and Nobunaga is impressed with his abilities. However, he orders his underlings to give Yasuke a bath because, you know, he thought he was dirty. And this is because they've never seen black people before, let alone someone with skin that dark. Thought he was dirty, gave him a bath, and then they was like, oh shit, wait a minute, that's his skin.
No shit, Sherlock.
Which is weird to me because if somebody's dirty, you can actually tell that they're dirty because, you know, their skin would look clumpy, like it would look like something is on their skin. Anyway, after he's trained, he gains a reputation after some time. A war breaks out, Nobunaga commits seppuku, and we cut to 20 years later. Yasuke is now laying low and working as a fisherman, the bitter old dude who's drinking his life away type of archetype. The plot will soon become less and less about Yasuke and more about this little girl named Saki. She apparently has some kind of special superpower that's hidden within her and it's making her appear all weak and sickly. But it's really just her powers manifesting and her body just isn't ready for it just yet. So Saki's mom seeks out Yasuke to get him to take them to this doctor who can actually, you know, help her with her condition. And of course, Yasuke is all reluctant at first because the path ahead is deadly and most people who travel that way don't return. But then eventually he changes his mind and he's like, all right, never mind, I'll help y'all. Along the way, they run into the henchman of the big bad, or the first big bad, who's this priest from Europe. The henchman consisting of a black dude from Benin who can summon ghost shadows, clones or something like that, a chick with a scythe, a giant robot, and this big ass Russian chick who can turn into a bear. The giant robot, by the way, who can't seem to stop being astounded at the fact that Yasuke is black.
He's black. The black man spoke Japanese.
And he is black.
Saki's mother gets killed in a fight between them and Yasuke, killed off way too damn early in my opinion. Saki then subconsciously uses her power to blast everybody away. Yasuke and Saki go back to the village and he continues to drink his life away looking all sad and shit. Then the priest seeks him out and asks where the little girl is after the little girl runs away when she finds out that her mother actually died in the fight. Yasuke refuses to give up where the little girl is, and then a battle between him and the henchmen happen. The henchmen overpower him, they beat him, they capture him. They then frame him for murdering Saki's mother, which basically turns most of the people in the village against him. Now, while the priest tortures Yasuke, Saki is on the run from the bear chick and the robot. Saki eventually uses her powers to like overpower them, and then she heads towards where the priest is at. So after the other two henchmen, being the black dude and the chick with the scythe, turn on the priest, who happens to actually be a demon,
obviously,
they then kinda help Yasuke in a way, and Saki, who arrives, eventually uses her powers and she's able to kill off the priest. Then the real villain of the show finally reveals herself at the end of episode 3 in a 6-episode show. And then what happens for the rest of the show is basically Yasuke decides he's gonna get back into the fighting game to help Saki get to the doctor. They reach the doctor after fighting some henchmen of the daimyo. They fight against an army. The priest henchmen team up with Yasuke and them, and Yasuke, still continuing to not really be all that important to the story, he helps Saki fight against the final boss and gets killed. Saki revives him with her deus ex machina ass powers, and she ends up getting some random ass Naruto Dragon Ball power up and ends up beating the daimyo, and they all go back to the village. Everything is right with the world and all that shit. Story's over. Like I said, it becomes less about Yasuke and more about Saki and her hidden powers. Like, old boy starts to recede and become more of a background or even a secondary character in his own show. I mean, like, dog, the show is literally called Yasuke, not the era of 1500s fantasy Japan featuring Yasuke. In addition to that, the story was more like a mix of Afro Samurai meets Gundam meets Onimusha. So basically a samurai mecha supernatural fantasy. Like, bruh, I think it's safe enough to say that this dude LaShawn really likes mechs. Like, even in stories where mechs don't even fit, dudes like, nah, throw some mechs on that bitch.
Throw some D's on that bitch.
Like, with this guy, the urge to put mechs into everything is stronger than bananas in a smoothie. It's like the show wanted to be Afro Samurai, but based on a real person, sort of. Like, it almost, and I mean almost, comes off as an attempt at being a copycat. Because in Afro Samurai, the setting is in an older version of Japan. Yet somehow they have computers, cell phones, TVs, heat-seeking missiles, cyborgs, and sophisticated androids. But there's also magic in that world, so it's not exactly unthinkable. Not to mention, they never implied that the story of Afro Samurai was meant to be viewed through a historical or a real-world type of lens. But as for this anime though, I mean, this story could have worked in a fantasy setting, because like I said, I wasn't expecting a one-for-one telling of the real-life story, and I wasn't expecting it to be super realistic. Like, an Afro Samurai meets Onimusha type of anime would have actually been dope, but when you decide to put mechs and giant robots in the shit, it makes it look kind of ridiculous. Because now you're just asking, how the hell are there robots in this era? Magic is understandable because magic is a very ancient thing, but unless you're trying to tell me that human beings in this world somehow figured out how to create automata at an earlier point in time, then I don't know how the hell else you're gonna justify this setting. But even then, it would still be weird, because it's like, hold up, even right now y'all still use boats to get from one part of the world to another, but y'all just skipped over cars, airplanes, and the internet and went straight to robots and AI.
Immersion killer.
Now, what I'll say about this is that it's a much clearer narrative than that of Cannon Busters, despite the ridiculous and rather unnecessary additions to it. A little girl has a serious problem with her body and needs special help to take care of this problem. Yasuke has to get her to the person who can help her. Along the way, other forces get in the way of their objective. Pretty simple and straightforward. Other things I dislike would be for personal reasons, not necessarily issues with the narrative. Well, you know, I'll say it's a mix of both. Like, for example, Ichika, who's Saki's mom, getting killed off that early on in the show was whack, because the way her character was being shown, I thought she was gonna be a much bigger deal than that. Then the priest, who seemed like he'd be the overarching villain of the story, gets murked in episode 3. Then the real villain shows up at the end of episode 3, and I'm like, bro, you gonna wait until now to show up? It's a 6-episode anime. The shit's halfway over and now you show up. Then the henchmen join forces with Yasuke, and then right when you start liking the henchmen, they start getting killed off, or at least most of them do. And yet again, the big woman gets killed. Like LaShawn, man to man, I gotta ask you this. Why you keep killing off the tall girls, bro? Now, like I said, I was hyped for this show. Heard Lakeith Stanfield was voicing Yasuke. Dope actor. Heard Flying Lotus was doing a soundtrack. Dope ass music artist. Heard Studio MAPPA was doing the animation. Dope ass animation studio. You know, just treat your staff better and pay them properly, and then, you know, y'all be good money. So yeah, I had some pretty high expectations since they were going hard like that. Now the animation was actually good and the fight scenes were good too. I mean, if it comes from Studio MAPPA, it's gonna be at least decent. You know, the hand-to-hand fights, I would say I enjoyed a lot more than the sword fights. The sword fights felt kind of basic, I'm not gonna lie. I was expecting some Ninja Scroll level swordplay. Overall, I would say what we got was acceptable, at least in my opinion. Overall, I give the show about a 7 out of 10. Now, overall, my opinion on the shows that LaShawn Thomas has created, I would say it's all right. Like, for example, like you ever eat some food and the food don't taste terrible, but it ain't exactly the best thing you've ever eaten. And you're like, you know what? If I ever get hungry and I can't think of anything else to eat, then I'll eat this. You know, it's kind of like that with the anime. Now, if you like these shows, then that's fine. My personal opinion isn't meant to change your opinion on something that you like. I'm just explaining why my opinion is what it is. Now, there's this ridiculous idea amongst Black people that we're not allowed to criticize each other on literally anything because criticizing is not only considered hating, but it also means you're trying to bring down another Black man or Black woman.
Man, what the fuck is you
what
talking about?
What the fuck about? Was that?
I'm sorry.
Like, that is so fucking dumb, bro. Hey, come on, son. If I'm my brother's keeper or my sister's keeper, then wouldn't that mean I would want what's best for my brother or my sister? Like, if I see you walking and you about to walk straight into a metal pole or step in some dog shit, the right thing to do would be for me to stop you and be like,
hey, you about to step in some shit!
Now, if we're enemies and I hate your ass, I'm hoping you step on a fresh piece of doodle. Like, the dog that just shat it out is only about a couple blocks ahead. I'ma hope you don't notice that you got dog booty nugget residue on your shoes until you get in your car. Then you get stuck in traffic and you like... Now, criticism, and I'm talking about genuine constructive criticism, is meant to bring about improvement amongst your peers. Just because I criticize something doesn't mean that I hate what I'm criticizing. Unless I say that I hate something or implicate that I hate something via just completely shitting on everything there is about a project, then you can assume that I hate something. But just so you know, you can criticize something and still like what you're criticizing. But in today's day and age, it's either you're a complete kiss ass or you just hating. Now, there has been some controversy surrounding LaShawn's ethical practices pertaining to his work. Arguments ranging from he underpays his staff to him not hiring Black writers on his original projects to him scamming his Kickstarter backers and blocking people on his social media platforms for calling him out on it. Now, I'll admit that I'm not entirely up to date with all that info in that regard, so I'll leave that for people who know a lot more than that and have an even more personal investment in those situations. But I will say this, and this is pertaining to anyone who does do this type of stuff. Underpaying your staff and scamming people who pay their hard-earned money to help your project come to life is just beyond fucked up. Especially when you take into account the amount of people in the future who will probably have to convince people that they're not going to do some janky shit with their donation money as opposed to using it to back the project. Underpaying your staff is also a good way to make sure that animators who may have wanted to work with you in the future think 100 times before working with your ass. Not to mention it'll also make at least some of your fan base look at you sideways. Another thing I'll say too is that not hiring Black writers and probably other staff positions is also fucked up, especially as a Black person who wants to create more Black representation in anime and animation in general. The way I see it, if you're gonna create a project and say that it's a Black movie project, animation project, video game project, etc., the way I see it, you want to call it Black made, Black owned, Black led, whatever you want to call it, right? Then shouldn't the production team, or at least most of the team, be Black people? Now, I'm not saying that every single person who's working on the project has to be Black. I'm just saying that, you know how people show those pictures of the cast and crew whenever like a movie project is finished or something like that for like a video game or a movie? I'm basically talking about in those pictures, at first glance, it should be obviously noticeable that a team of Black people worked on said project. Now, I don't know what the exact number should be, but you shouldn't have to look and squint your eyes and search through the crowd to see where all the Black people are sprinkled out at. If you want to say that a project is a Black project, then that should extend to the people in front of the camera as well as behind the camera. I'm talking about Black writers, animators, voice actors, storyboard artists, concept artists, composers, etc. It should be in the fabric of the project itself if you're going to advertise it as such. I'm just saying, this should be more than just one or three Black people involved with the production if you're gonna call it that. See, a Black person being the face of something doesn't mean anything other than symbolic or hypothetical milestones at the end of the day. You can't say that a business is Black owned if a Black person doesn't actually own the business or whatever else. But see, there's cats who think that being the face of something is the same thing as being the person who's running the show. There's a black woman who does the Popeyes commercials, and yeah, she makes a lot of money off those, but that don't mean that she owns the Popeyes franchise. See, this is what I like to call the Obama effect, meaning that people, specifically black people, who think that because they see a black person who's represented as the face of something, that it means that a black person is running said thing. Now, the figurehead ain't the one calling the shots for real, it's just made to look that way. Now, the motherfuckers who sit at these kinds of tables are the ones who are making the final decisions at the end of the day. The power behind the throne is where the hammer is really brought down. Bruce Wayne is the head of Wayne Enterprises, but if you saw The Dark Knight Rises, the board of directors straight up fired his ass right to his face. Even took his damn name off the building while his car was getting repoed. Norman Osborn got fired from Oscorp, even though he's also the head of Oscorp Industries.
You know how much I sacrificed?
You think people were really scared of Joffrey? You could say they were annoyed by him, they hated him, but by no means were they scared of him. A gang of kids could easily jump and whoop his ass and leave him somewhere stinking. But nah, they were really scared of cats like Tywin Lannister. You know, people like the Kingsguard, the Hound, the Mountain, and other monsters that Tywin had on his payroll that really had people shitting enough bricks to build a wall big enough to keep the White Walkers out. But anyway, back on the whole thing about black-led projects. You see, I myself am working on my own original comic books / manga, and I intend to one day have them adapted into several anime series. And see, the way I would want to advertise it would be as a black project, as well as have a shit ton of black people, qualified black people, also work on these projects with me. And I don't mean like just for the sake of representation and shit, but because I actually want to help shatter the narrative that black people's stories can only be about dysfunctional toxic relationships, broken families, drug dealing, and other sad hood movie shit. Black people can have martial art movies, action movies, fantasy, sci-fi, horror, Afrofuturism, and wholesome romance stories just like everybody else can. But like I've said before, and like I will say a billion times more, it's up to us to make that happen, because no one else is going to do it for us, nor should they. Another thing that needs to be shattered is this generational curse, racial curse, or whatever the hell it is that keeps black people from cooperating with each other and building together on certain things. Because way too often do we hear about a bunch of black people working on something together, but then something goes wrong, the whole thing either falls apart or gets canceled before anything really comes to fruition. It's like egos get in the way, everybody want to be the head nigga in charge, fragile, immature motherfuckers take genuine criticism as an insult to their skill level or intelligence, or you have black people who are able to get through the door, but then after a while of rubbing elbows with them folks, but they start to feel themselves, they get a big head and get real egotistical and cocky, and then they start blocking and gatekeeping other black people from getting through the door, acting as if only a certain amount of black people should get to be there with them, or acting like they should be the only one who gets to make it. So instead of helping the others who helped them get to where they are, they just pull the fucking ladder up with them. But then we'll jump in front of a camera and put on this facade that they want to be some sort of trailblazer, an inspiration, a shining beacon of hope to other black creatives that they can also reach new heights within the industry too. Fake ass niggas, I tell you, bro. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I'm really sick and tired of that shit at this point. Like, we could talk about black excellence and revolutionizing things all day, every day, but doing the work is not a one-person job. This shit right here is a team effort. Now, if we're not proactively trying to help each other to create this black art renaissance or whatever you want to call it, but instead we rather just trip each other up or sabotage or block and gatekeep other black people from getting to where we got to get to, then this shit eventually becomes our own fault at the end of the day. That's just my two cents. Let me know what y'all think, and we can chop it up in the comment section. Peace.